let's take a look at an introduction to paired difference procedures. Let's start with a couple of examples. In an experiment investigating reaction times in 6 volunteers, volunteers were randomly assigned to one of two groups. One group received alcohol, and another group stayed sober, and then their reaction times in milliseconds were measured. We could consider these two groups to be, in a sense, independent samples. So methods of analysis based on independent samples would be appropriate here. Something like the pooled variance T procedure would be an option. But this experiment down here is a little bit different. In this experiment, 4 volunteers had their reaction times measured twice, once when they were sober and once after drinking. So here we have 2 measurements on the same individual. Here we have reaction times, sober and after drinking, for Mary, and then for Helen, etc., etc. We're taking 2 measurements on the same individual, and these observations are not independent, and so we can't use methods of analysis based on independent samples. We're going to have to use another method of analysis here, and we'll see that we can use a paired difference procedure to analyze this data. Why set up an experiment this way? Taking 2 measurements on the same individual can serve to reduce the variability. What I mean by that is that person-to-person variability plays less of a role, and it becomes easier to isolate the effect of interest, such as the effect of alcohol on reaction times. Here's a slightly different but related example. Students given a test before and after a French course. Here we have the pre-test score before the course, and the post-test score after the course. And here again, we have 2 measurements on the same individual. And our goal, in a sense, is to see how much this course helped. And here again, these 2 samples are not independent samples. And so methods based on independent samples would not be appropriate. Here we have 2 dependent samples. It doesn't have to be 2 measurements on the same individual for it to be a dependent sample situation. Here's an example of a study investigating possible differences in the size of the right hippocampus, an area of the brain, in 15 pairs of identical twins. One twin was affected by schizophrenia, and the other was not. Identical twins are very valuable in statistical studies like this, as genetic variability is eliminated, and we can focus in on the effect we're interested in. Here we don't have 2 measurements on the same individual, but again we have dependent samples. This is one pair of twins, so there is a relationship there. The observations within each pair are related and dependent. Let's look at one other common situation before we look at how we might analyze this type of data. In a matched pairs experimental design, individuals are grouped into pairs according to variables that are likely to affect the response. For example, they might be matched according to age or gender or weight or stage of a disease or a variety of other possible variables. The treatment being investigated, which might be something like a new surgery method or a drug, is randomly assigned to one of the 2 members of the pair, and the other receives a standard treatment or a placebo. How do we analyze this type of data? The first point to note is that methods based on independent samples are not appropriate here, so it would not be appropriate to use something like the pooled variance T procedure. To analyze this type of data, we take the difference between the observations within each pair and treat the differences as a single sample. Let's go back to the twins example to see what I mean by that. Here again's the data, and we're going to take the difference within each pair. I'm going to take the measurement for the affected twin and subtract that of the not affected twin. We just as easily could go in the other direction. We just need to keep track of which way we took the differences in order to reach the appropriate conclusions in the end. But I'm going to take these differences, 1.55 minus 1.72, or minus 0.17, 1.87 minus 2.16, minus 0.29, and 1.24 minus 1.09, which is 0.15. These 3 differences now represent our single sample. I'm going to label these 3 observations as X1, X2, and X3. Some sources might use Ds to represent the values, like D1, D2, and D3, but I'm going to use Xs to keep the notation consistent with what we used when we talked about one-sample problems. We're now going to be interested in summary statistics of those differences. And so we're going to use things like X bar, which is going to be the sample mean of the differences, and S, which is going to be the sample standard deviation of those differences. We are often interested in estimating mu, the population mean difference. And we may wish to calculate a confidence interval for mu. And we very often wish to test the null hypothesis that the population mean difference is zero. This might mean something like a drug has no effect, or that alcohol has no effect on reaction times, although that's certainly not true. One common way we have of investigating this is the paired difference T procedure. Let's take a look at that. In the paired difference T procedures, we carry out the usual one-sample t-tests and confidence intervals, but on the differences. The assumptions of the paired difference T procedures are that the sample differences are a simple random sample from the population of differences, and that the population of differences is normally distributed. Although, as per usual, the normality assumption is not very important if we have a large sample size. To construct a confidence interval for mu, the population mean difference, we're going to use our usual methods. We're going to start with our sample mean difference, and then we're going to add and subtract this margin of error. The margin of error, again, is made up of the t value times our standard error. And the standard error is our usual one-sample standard error for means. This is simply going to be s over the square root of n. S is the sample standard deviation of the differences, and n is the number of differences that we have. And when we're looking to find our appropriate t value, which we've discussed many times previously, we need the appropriate degrees of freedom. And here again, the degrees of freedom are n minus 1. We are often interested in testing the null hypothesis that the population mean difference is zero. This might mean that a new drug is not more effective than a placebo on average, or that brain sizes of schizophrenic and non-schizophrenic twins are equal on average. We could test a different hypothesized value, but zero is by far the most common one. Here we would choose the appropriate alternative hypothesis, calculate the value of the test statistic, find the p-value, and reach a conclusion in the usual one-sample ways. I have a video where I work through an example of that. If the null hypothesis and the assumptions are true, this test statistic would have a t-distribution with n-1 degrees of freedom. So we would find our p-value from that t-distribution with n-1 degrees of freedom. If we don't feel it's reasonable to assume normality, there are other options available. We could use a nonparametric procedure, sometimes called a distribution-free procedure. There are different possibilities here, including the signed test or the signed rank test.